Hey, Peter, guess what? I found your disc.
You found my disc?
Here at Will's Park. How can I get this back to you?
So, Peter, tell us a little bit about your past and your history in the sport of Frisbee in general and how you came to become, you know, one of the leading authorities on disc dogs competitions.
Do we have that much time?
Probably not, but we can give it a shot.
Well, I grew up in New York City, and it was right across from Central Park. I went there during the summers and just played for fun. I got involved in the junior championships, won a number of competitions, went to the nationals, finished third overall. And then I got involved in the adult competitions, won the men's world championship in 1976 and the world accuracy championship. At that point, I was like, well, I reached my goal, but I'll still keep playing. And the next year, I finished second in disc golf in the worlds, and then got involved in ultimate, finished second with Cornell in the ultimate nationals. And then I decided to get a dog, and we won the world championship, and we retired from that undefeated. And my goal at that point was just to get involved in the sport and promote it and try to grow it worldwide.
One of the things that y'all promote is that any dog can do it. And while it's true, any dog can do it, there's like a really select few that excel at the championship level. Tell us about that.
Well, I think that's true of any sport. You have athletes, soccer players, football players, basketball players that are good. But, you know, college, they excel. But only a certain group can go on to the pro level. And the same is with disc dogs. You know, we try to encourage people to get involved in the sport regardless, because it's great for the dog's health, it's great for bonding between the owner and the dog, and then if you want to take it to the next level, we offer, you know, a tremendous competition elements. We've got three competition series. If you want freestyle or a timed event or a distance event, we have it all. Our feelings are there's so many great dogs out there for adoption. Humane societies, shelters, even if you want a purebred dog like a border collie or an Aussie, they have rescue organizations for those. So you don't have to breed a dog for the sport. And you don't have to have a purebred dog to succeed in the sport. Many mutts have gone on to win world championships.
I'm glad you brought that up, because that was the case with Roxanne. She was a lab chow mix we got from the Cobb Humane Shelter. And she had what I call the Jones. She wanted that disc. She didn't care what was going on. All she wanted was another throw.
I mean, that's the whole thing about a focused disc dog. And that is that they'd rather play than almost anything else. And a lot of people, when they ask, well, how do I get my dog started? You know, they're thinking treats. It's not treats. It's the next throw.
Yes.
And so many good dogs I'll see out there, and their owner's just used to the treats. And the dog has to stop, and it's like, yeah, I'll take the treat, but they really don't need it. And I say, don't give it to them. And then suddenly, the dog's twice as fast and more focused.
Absolutely. And that was the thing with Roxanne. She was so good, excelled so well at the distance competition, where it was how many throws could you get at what distance within
a minute.
A minute, 60 mm-hmm. seconds. And man, she was so fast. And whether or not we won depended on how well I threw. Because if I got it out there, she caught it.
She would
catch
it.
And she was so fast bringing it back to the line.
Well, the thing about it is the dogs, they don't understand it's a competition. They're just looking at having fun with you. And that's what we try to reinforce with the competitors is, look, there only can be maybe one winner today, but really, in a competition, but really you're all winners because you're out there playing with your dog and having a good time. And that is always our focus. You know, it's nice to have winners and losers and have goals, but the ultimate thing should be to have fun with your dog and make it fun for them. After we won the world championship, I didn't want to make the same mistake that I did on the human side, and that was I won the world championship, I was all focused, I tried as hard as I could, I reached my goal, and I still competed. Next year, but without the practice. Next year, I took second in the world. And the next year, I was like fifth or sixth, and I was like, you know, what's the point? My goal isn't to win it multiple times. So with the dogs, I said, that was my goal, I won it. Now, what's my next goal? My next goal was to promote the sport worldwide and grow the sport. When I competed for the world championship, it was 3 hours long, 12 competitors, and they were all from the US. Now, it lasts over a week, over 200 competitors from all over the world. So something that we've been doing has worked, and that is we go out to different countries. I've been to Japan like 45 times, been to China, Korea, Mexico, Europe, and doing free clinics and judging and exhibitions, and it's really paid off, and it's exciting to see at the World Championships new events that we've created, like pairs freestyle, two people, one dog. And the reason we don't do two dogs and one person, let's say, is safety. It's much riskier to have two dogs running up and down the field at one time. So we decided, let's focus on two people. We can add more discs, so we have 10 discs. And there's amazing things that you can do with two people instead of one. We added a micro dog division for small athletic dogs because we noticed that it was hard for them to compete with the big dogs.
Well, you even made a disc just for that.
Exactly,
didn't you?
Yeah. The whole idea was we were so successful with the big discs that people said, well, how about me? You know. And the funny thing is that small dogs like a corgi, they could catch the big discs, but as they were running, the disc would sag and they'd be tripping over it on the ground. Or if they had it this way, then it went up in their face and they couldn't see. So this was easier for them to catch and run with and control. So they've both been very successful, and we added a micro dog division in our competitions for those great athletic dogs, corgis, Jack Russells, mixed breeds.
Now, in your life, you've made quite a few discs. You've got, how many patents on discs do you have?
Well, I have several patents, and they're not all currently in existence.
Okay.
Our patent on our line still is valid, and it's based on the gripping surface on the top and the bottom of the disc. And our thoughts were that the better grip that you would have, the more control of your throws, therefore the better chance for your dog to make a catch. The old style discs had the ridges on the outside. They would lose shape from time to time. They would crack and shatter in the cold. They were unstable. So when we came
out, very hard to throw. That was what I competed with.
Well, that too, yeah. And that's what I won with, because we all had to use those discs. But it wasn't ideal. And so, because it was never, in all fairness, designed to be used with the dogs. Our approach was, okay, we've been involved in the sport. One of my business partners, Jeff Perry, is a pilot, so he knows a lot about flight. Of course, I know a lot about disc sports through my experience. So what we wanted to do was improve upon what was existing. So we removed the ridges on the outside of the disc because they would just basically collect grit and act like revolving sandpaper in your dog's teeth. Mm-hmm. We reinforced the area where the flight plate meets the rim because that would be where the disc would snap. We added the gripping on the top and the bottom for improved grip. We reduced the size of the disc so it would be easier for more people to be able to hold the disc. And then in terms of its performance, it's a very stable disc. You throw it flat, it flies flat. And that's important in disc sports in the dog side, because the minute your dog puts any kind of punctures on the disc, they become less stable. And so the more stable you start with, the better, you know, you're gonna end up with. The approach to the sport, getting involved in the sport, how do you do it? How do people get in the sport? Well, they come two ways. One is they're either a disc person, disc golf, ultimate, freestyle, and they say, oh yeah, I'm a disc person, let me get a dog and get involved. Well, so they have the advantage of being able to throw. On the other hand, you have people that love dogs and have athletic dogs, and they're playing ball or throwing a stick or doing agility, and they say, well, now I want to get involved in disc sports. Well, they know how to train a dog, but they don't know how to throw.
Yes.
So it's all how they both come together that's important. So the throwers have to learn the dog training part, and the dog training people have to learn the throwing part. So what's one of the great things about the sport is it's not something that you just send your dog out and do. It's like, okay, go run these agility things or go fly ball and hit the and get the ball. It's we have to perform together. Whether it be just distance, you make a good throw, your dog brings it back, makes a good catch, brings it back, or you're doing the freestyle and you have to be in sync. So that's really what separates the beginners from the experienced people is how well you work together with your dog. And also what I like to tell people is when you're developing a freestyle routine, don't develop it based on last year's World Championship routine, because they're a different dog and a different thrower. you have to base what you are doing with your dog on what they enjoy doing and what they do well and what you do and enjoy doing. And that's the way you'll be successful, not by copying somebody else.
It seems like there are certain tricks that are kind of universal. The back ball, the chest ball, you know, we all did them back in the day. But then, you know, some of the things that I saw, I didn't see at the world. Some of the things I did, like I used to do a toe throw where
right,
I would kick it up and Roxanne would catch it. And just different elements. So it's like everybody kind of brings their own flavor to the sport. But what was really exciting was seeing the pairs competition. That was, I was blown away by the way you elevated the sport by adding that element. It was, entertaining for everybody.
It is. When it's done well. When it's not done so well, it's two people with a dog just flailing away. And there's a big difference. You can tell when people have been practicing for this and working together. And that it's more challenging because you have to do it together, and that's time commitment and creativity. There's a lot more to it than on the individual basis where you can just grab your dog, go out to the park and start practicing. So how do people get involved in the sport? If they don't see somebody playing in the park, they can go to our website, skyhoundz.com, and we've got a beginner's guide, a free beginner's guide. They got nothing to lose. And the neat thing is it's available in 7 languages.
Oh, fantastic.
And we'd like to have more languages. It's a question of we don't speak those languages, so we need volunteers. But if you speak English, of course, Japanese, Spanish, Korean, you know, we got you covered and more. And then if you want to get more involved, we actually have, of course, Disc Dogs, the complete guide, which is, this is very extensive in terms of covering competition, the history of the sport, travel, strategy, and there's just a lot of fun reading in here if you're a dog lover. We also have a training DVD, Disc Dogs training DVD. So if you are more visual, then you can get the DVD. If you like to bring something with you to the park, then the book's for you.
Yeah, your first editions of that were, you know, the Bible as far as us getting into the sport. It was the one resource we had that really allowed us to compete at the champion level, which we did.
Well, that's the other thing that we wanted to do is create ways for people to get involved in the sport. Because when I started, it was just I'd see people and I'd talk to them and try to figure things out. And, of course, that was before the internet. So now you have the internet as a resource. You have books. You have DVDs. So there's a lot more available to people getting involved in the sport, which is great. More resources, better players, more dogs, more involvement, the sport grows, everybody's a winner.
You were even involved with Ashley Whippet, the first great Frisbee dog, legendary. Mm-hmm. You were the thrower, correct?
Occasionally, yeah. His owner, Alex Stein, and Ashley Whippet, everyone gives credit for kind of starting the sport, if you will. Alex had this great dog, and it wasn't like he trained the dog for it. He was throwing a disc with his buddies, And his dog just ran out, jumped up, made an incredible catch, and it was like, wow. And so he built upon that, went to California, and basically tried to convince Whammo. It's like, look, you know, we should have a sport for all of this. And Whammo was like, yeah, whatever. And then he snuck his dog out during a nationalized television game, baseball game. And they jumped onto the field at Dodger Stadium and just started throwing. And nationally televised, so of course, in the stadium audience all saw this. And this was, can you imagine the first time you ever saw a dog do this? And the dog was amazing. I mean, it was a little whippet that would jump like 10 feet off the ground. So unfortunately, he didn't just jump into fame and fortune at that point. He got arrested. The dog got lost for several days. And of course, he was panicking because it's like, where's my dog? The good news is that, of course, he found the dog. He was reunited with the dog. There was an executive, Irv Lander, at the game from Whammo and said, wow, this is great. We need to do something. And that was really the beginning of creating the whole sport, because Whammo went on to create an event with Alex, and that's what started it all. So, you know, it was kind of an accidental thing and good fortune. And it wasn't like he was probably the only one who played, but of course he had a super dog that got noticed. And the way we connected was at the World Championship. They had the humans and they had the dogs. And I was always a dog lover growing up. I had Dalmatians as a kid. And so I gravitated to the dog people. And I was a good thrower, so I was asked to make the long throws for the dogs in the stadium, you know, the 80-yard long distance throws. And I started working with Alex that way, and we did a number of racetrack shows and performances at sporting events, football games and stuff, where he would start out and throw with his dog, and then I would finish with the long throws to his dog. And that's kind of what got me started on thinking dogs would be great for me. The thing is, after I won the World Championship as an individual, I started doing performances around the world. And people said, oh, well, that's great, but where's your dog? And at first it was kind of annoying because I'd spent years of my life, you know, crafting my skills and, you know, getting to where I had. And then they were like, well, where's your dog? I'm like, but I thought about it. And again, I loved dogs. I was like, you know, it would be great having a dog traveling around the country with me. And maybe he'd be good enough to be in my shows. So let's give it a shot. Well, I got Wizard, and he was so good, I decided to compete with him, and he ended up winning the World Championship. He was the youngest to win it at that point. He was less than 2 years old, and then we retired and went on to all this other stuff. So it was kind of neat how that all came to happen. And it's also awesome to see the growth of the sport since then. It started back in 74. And now it's recognized around the world and participated in across the world. You know, Russia, I mean, China, I mean, Korea. You know, these are places maybe you say, well, they eat dogs or they don't treat dogs well. And we're trying to change people's attitudes and mindsets about these wonderful...
how a dog should be treated in your society.
Exactly. And when I first started going to Japan back in the early 1990s, my feeling was that people looked at dogs as objects. Well, I've got a TV, I've got a stereo, I've got a couch, I've got a dog. And they'd be, okay, the dog, their place is outside in the kennel. I go see him, I go feed him, I pet him. Not really part of the family. Wouldn't be in the house because, oh my goodness, you know, we got to take our shoes off. We can't bring a dirty dog in the house. Well, over time, I see that's changed, where the dogs are now really part of their family. They'll bring them inside, and they love them just like we do in this country. So it's really exciting and encouraging to see these kind of changes take place over time.